We are now going to continue on after the Some Girls Tour 1978 in August. We're going to start off with Sessions in LA and continue on in no particular order here, Saturday Night Live, Keith's Trial, Ronnie solo album, Patty, Bahamas Sessions, New Barbarians Tour, and the Oshawa gig, Pathe Marconi Paris Sessions, Stones Gear, songs recorded in all the sessions, the Emotional Rescue album, and information about it, and my analysis of the album's songs. Plenty of information in between all this, for sure. Drama, yeah. So you sit back, relax, do what you do to make yourself relaxed, and enjoy this one. World Events, 1979. A lot happening. Soviets invade Afghanistan. Idi Amin is overthrown. A lot of things going on in Africa. We got Iran having a lot of issues and students seizing the U.S. Embassy in Tehran. Sandinistas in Nicaragua. As we see in sports, a lot was going on also. And music. The top 10. We have Bee Gees, Rod Stewart, Gloria Gaynor, Bee Gees again, Doobie Brothers, Blondie's up there, Peaches and Herbs. Oh, fun. Music top 10. The movies. Superman, Clint Eastwood, got Rocky 2, Alien, Amityville Horror, Star Trek, Moonraker, Muppet Movie, California Suite, and the great one, Deer Hunter. 1979 albums. Top one, Off the Wall, Michael Jackson. Then again, we got The Clash, London Calling. Again, we got The Disco and Bad Girls, Donna Summer. Pink Floyd, AC/DC. Seems like every other one changes. Joy Division, Unknown Pleasures, Fleetwood Mac, Elvis, Tom Petty, Police, Funkadelic, Gang of Four, Neil Young, The Knack. A lot of good ones. Biggest thing going on, major events, was the Iran-Iraq war that broke out. We had a bunch of sports events going on, of course, and we could see what happened in there. How about the albums? We're starting off a little different than last year, 79, AC/DC and Talking Heads, Joy Division, Motorhead, Springsteen, Prince. Less disco. Seeing some good rock and roll albums for sure. We're going to jump down to number 41, and that's our Emotional Rescue. Then we have Jay Giles, Stevie Winwood, Bob Marley, Uprising, Black Sabbath. The big campaign in 79 was Disco Sucks. It was huge at this time, those of you who remember. July 12th, 79 was a big event at Kaminsky Park, the baseball stadium where the Chicago White Sox played. They had a doubleheader against the Tigers. WLUP DJ Steve Dahl headed up a disco demolition campaign, and in between the two games, he was going to blow up disco records. All you had to do was come in, bring your records, and get in for a dollar. They thought about 5,000 people would show, but they were just pouring and sneaking in. More than they even imagined. They put the records into a box and they did a countdown and blew it up as Steve made his announcements. And as the second game was starting during the warm-ups, fans started running onto the field. There was no security. They just rushed it. It was a blitz, a riot. Kind of embarrassing. And they really tore up the field real bad. They started to disperse only after 40 minutes. And as the police came in. And it was the game was forfeited by the White Sox. And 39 arrests. So we got the summer, the end of the summer, August 78, and we're going to go through the summer of 1980. About 2 years of time here. So with the Stones finishing up the Some Girls tour, the band was still feeling it. And you know Keith, he doesn't want to stop, especially while they got the momentum going. He wanted to get back in the studio. So they agreed to 2 weeks of sessions at the old RCA Studios in Hollywood, now known as Wally Heider. So Ronnie rents a home. Might have been Laurel Canyon, not 100% sure, but in the home of Skip Taylor. He's a music producer, songwriter. He managed Canned Heat. Keith would also follow. The house hung over a cliff. And there it was, and Keith was in the back house, and along was with him was Lil. Mick rented Linda Ronstadt's house. Now the LA scene, it became a good excuse for Keith to dabble a bit, as the creeps came out and they saw an easy victim as they were within sight of the Sunset Strip. Now, with Keith and Lil living in that small house behind Ronnie, one morning, early in the morning, a neighbor had noticed black smoke pouring out of the window. They called the fire department and the police. Now, as the fire trucks were headed there, Keith's ammunition started shooting off. They were huddled there, not knowing what the heck is going on, half naked, with a blanket wrapped around them. And a car pulls up to Keith and Lil. And the driver was a cousin of Anita, who happened to live nearby. How he knew to come there, I have no idea about that. But they both got in and they disappeared just as the police arrived. Keith realized that his equipment got damaged. He had the Zamitis, the one with the skulls and pistols and daggers, that was a casualty. Along with that was a Martin acoustic. I mentioned this in the Some Girls documentary about Lil. I don't think many fans realize how pivotal Lil Wurgulis was for Keith. As she came into his life, he was more grounded. Well, that's Keith's grounded, not the normal grounded. She got him through the 78 tour. She's smart, pretty, and energetic, and cool. She was dazzling, Keith would say. She made Keith learn how to laugh again and brought Keith back from the abyss and took his mind off the stuff. A breath of fresh air, not stagnant. She brought him structure also. So about the gear that the Stones used. This is during their sessions and the New Barbarians tour. Keith added a few. Gibson Les Paul Jr., the TV Jr. double cutaway, 1958. This is used from 1971 to the present. Keith named it Tumbling Dice or Dice. It originally had a decal of a pair of dice by the control knobs, tele-control knobs. The decal was covering the wear. This guitar has Grover tuners, a Leo Kwan badass adjustable bridge as enhancements. We tend to think of Keith with teles, and a lot of people comment about the teles and the open tuning, but there's more to it. This baby's right up there as a main axe. Has a P90, no frills, middle around sound, a road warrior. Used for standard tuning or a capo at the seventh. You've seen this, baby. There was a Fender Tele Deluxe, which is different than the one you've seen, the Tele Custom. The Custom that you've seen has a single coil at the bridge. The Deluxe has two Fender humbuckers, wide range, Strat neck, ash body, maple neck, and enlarged headstock. I own a 1975 original version, and I have to say, whenever I pick up this guitar to play it, live or in home or to jam, it just makes me smile. It is a fantastic playing and sound. This blonde beauty had a single cutaway, had a bird's eye maple top, and the neck was 24 frets of maple. Guitar was fitted with two black EMG humbucking pickups with a preamp powered by a 9-volt battery. Had the volume and tone control with a 3-way toggle, 5 shallow tuner pegs, and a stainless steel adjustable bridge. Ted's intention was to make other copies of this guitar, and that's what that blueprint is for. He wanted to make it a limited edition, a production about 25 quarterly, 100 a year. He never came close to this, but few have ever surfaced in the user guitar market. Keith would use his other typical guitars, the main ones also. Now Ronnie, during the Barbarians tour, he used a blonde Travis Bean TB-1000 for a couple shows. And he also had a Travis Bean, a special one that had an etching, a red one. And it also had May 1579 for Ron Wood from Travis Bean. Now Keith would also use Ronnie's blonde Gibson SJ200 acoustic. It had dual pick guards. Couldn't miss this one. Same configuration as the Everly Brothers model. It contained a Sunrise pickup for the sound, and he played this, Keith did, for Prodigal Son, and I'm sure they used this in the studio also. As mentioned, again, they would use similar gear for the studio sessions and some live. Charlie would use his 1957 Natural Wood kit. Bill had his Travis Bean TB-2000 bass and a Dallas tuxedo. Now, Ronnie also had a black Gibson Les Paul Custom. He had a Sunburst Gibson S-1. Another Zomitis with the metal front. Keith also had the 1957 Sunburst Gibson Les Paul Jr. I've talked about the MXR pedals with some girls, especially when it started. The Phase. Well, that was the Phase 90 and 100. And I've mentioned, and Keith has mentioned and talked about in interviews, the Green Box. That really came about in these sessions. It's the MXR analog delay. It was the favorite guitar effect for Keith and both Ronnie, as it gave a rockabilly, sort of a slapback echo on the guitar. And you could hear it on the cuts. August 14th on Australian TV, there was a show, you know the guy's face, but you may not know his name. The show was the Norman Gunston Show. Well, they showed some clips of him interviewing the Stones in Memphis at the hotel room, and also probably where the press was meeting them back in June 28th. And you saw this clip before. I showed it on the intro of one of my docs, Some Girls, where he asks, why did you name the album Some Girls? And Keith says, I couldn't remember. They're all the fucking names. And also, this was on Video Rewind, that that VHS tape, if you have ever seen that. I'm sure many of you have. And at the end of it, there's Norman chasing Mick in a bathrobe after the show, and Mick screaming at him to get out of the limo, which is hilarious. But there is one clip here also that was not shown, and again, I wanted to show this to you.
Hi, Mr. Jagger. How are you?
Sit down.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. Oh, on the bed.
Well, there's nowhere else.
Oh, okay. I don't want to sound like I'm sucking up to you or anything, you know, but I've been a great fan of yours ever since, you know, you were with the Beatles. This new band, Shubik Doo, and everything.
You know that I never really was with the Beatles.
I mean, Linda McCartney said you were.
I'm sorry. Relationship with Linda McCartney, it's got nothing to do. I mean, take you down to be so rude. I mean, like, this obviously got to be cut.
McCartney took. Mr. Jagger, your new record, what's that called? That's called.
Some Girls.
I understood you. No, your accent's, you know, fine. I just want to thank you for doing the interview with me, because I know you don't usually do interviews.
That's right.
Is it because you like me?
No, I don't like you.
And good for your career, eh?
But, yeah.
Now, we do know Keith is headed for a trial in October. So on August 15th, Dr. Anita Stevens in New York City claims and reports Keith is continuing his treatment and psychotherapy and shown important improvement and higher self-esteem. And as I mentioned before, the Stones go into the sessions in LA. That's the old RCA Studios. They did some work in their early years. They were there with Chris Kimsey, E. McLagan on organ. Jim Keltner was there for percussion, I believe just one day. Bobby Keys came in on August 31st. They moved ahead. So they get into the studio. They do a lot of covers. They also do Summer Romance and Where the Boys Go, taken from Pathe Marconi in earlier sessions. But they do a couple of their own tunes also. One of those tunes is a Jagger Richards, What Gives You the Right? It's also known as The Right to Think. I believe this one was done earlier in the Paris sessions. And it was worked on early in August. One of the early tunes they did includes Ian Mack. And you can hear some slight phase and pedal steel. Lyrics, I know you've been running all over New York City with someone new. Life's so easy. So much fun when you are singer on the run. This is a ballad about 6 minutes 20 seconds long. Next tune, a Chuck Willis tune from the 50s, What Am I Living For?, also known as If Not For You. Chuck's version is kind of similar to the Stones here, but with saxophone and background singers. Sort of a 50s slow dance tune. But here the Stones, drums, and bass tick away, keeping the very slow pace with a wonderful clean guitars with Ian Mack on electric organ. It has those twang guitars and leads.
Oh,
My First Plea. One of those songs that should have been on Keith's 77 solo sessions. The sessions that he did when he was in Toronto and he went in the studio with just Ian Stewart. Well, and Anita and Marlon. It's a continuation of Sweetness. This one is from Jimmy Reed, sung by Keith. This one is so worth it to have on the album. Oh, wait a minute. It's not on any album. Shit. This shows how prime they were at the sessions in LA. Mick on harmonica, Ian Mack on here. They would end up doing about 4 versions of this song. Your Angel Steps Out of Heaven, a tune written by Jack Ripley, who worked with George Jones. It was released by George in 1968. Other folks had covered it, but one of the better ones was by Gram Parsons and also the Burritos. Well, Keith delivers another somber version with the lead, backing vocals, and believe it's him on piano. Ronnie's on pedal steel, and there's an organ which most likely is Ian McLagan. Well, this tune, I couldn't find any archives of Stones playing it, but they did do One Night.
Those first Sun records with Elvis, you know, here is Scotty Moore's guitar, just, you know what I mean? It's like, I grew up and I listened to that stuff saying, this cat is incredible. To me, those early records are like, man, you know, this cat's got vision. I don't know, he just fell down into the hole, you know, but at the same time, you'll never take away that incredible influence he had on my generation, at least. So I didn't want to know, I didn't want to meet a fallen idol, maybe, you know. And I realized that he really wasn't his own man.
Great versions of Chuck's Back in the USA. Just classic Chuck for the Stones. This one boogies the way you would imagine. Ian Stewart on piano, probably. This one makes me smile for sure. This tune, Blues with a Feeling, a tune that was made by someone you're going to say, who? Marion Walter Jacobs. But you know him. You know him as Little Walter. He toured with the Stones back in 64 in Britain. He was with Muddy Waters until going solo. Mick is enjoying this one. Ian Stewart on this one also. Ian just loves this style of playing. You can imagine how much all the Stones enjoyed playing this tune. This is the roots of the Stones, another smoky club, dimly lit, with just blue lights on. Can you imagine hearing them play this live? What can I say? You hear it for yourself. And I'm dragging this one on purpose so you could hear this tune. Tallahassee Lassie, a 1959 tune done by Freddie Cannon, a 50s style tune. Our engineer buddy Barry Sage from Some Girls was in the studio at Wally Heater just to hang. He recalled that they were so relaxed and having fun playing these covers. They felt it. And I knew they would not be an album type material, but they enjoyed the jam. However, fast forward to 2011, this was included in the Some Girls reissue CD, selected by Don Was and Mick. Like the original, a rockabilly tonkiness. I'll let you know. The bass playing and the pedal steel, all Ronnie. And Ian Mack is on organ and Mick on electric piano. This one could have been brought home. I really, really like this groove instrumental. 6 minutes, 55 seconds long, and one of the few originals played at this session. I Ain't Superstitious. This is Willie Dixon's tune, brought in to the front line by Howlin' Wolf. This song was played in that wonderful London Howlin' Wolf session with Bill and Charlie and Eric, Winwood, etc. All individual pieces playing, giving us the Stones as a whole with straight ahead blues. You can hear Mick giving it and the dual pianos. Jimmy Reed Blues Jam. Yeah, they were jamming. What would you expect here? Exactly this. Now, Ian Mack would say in his bio, it took a real tough time to get some session fees from them. Straight blues jam, slow. Pace slow and it sounds like a nice 6 minute and 50 second warm up. Serious Love. It's about a minute and 38 seconds long. A nice little reggae piece with Keith singing and Ronnie and Sly Dunbar. Very short. I'm guessing Sly on the drums. Not sure if Bill's on bass though. The Harder They Come. Yes, we know this is a Keith song. Mick actually also did some singing on it too. I can't find outtake. And we know Keith would eventually release the single in December of 78. This was also recorded back in December 76 at Island Studios in London. The song's instruments are so well placed. The bends and the playing style that Keith does just makes you smile. And when he does it, simple as some of the things may sound, it just comes out golden. Jimmy Cliff, who starred in the title movie, The Harder They Come, also wrote the title track. He always wanted to be a movie star. He was already huge in Europe and Jamaica with his musical career. And this movie is about a reggae singer, Ivanhoe Martin, wishing he would become a successful Jamaican singer. He finds himself connected to drug pushers and corrupt record producers. He lets nothing get in his way, not even the law. It's about Jamaican struggles. It's not professionally made or edited, but the soundtrack just lifted the reggae music to the world. It was released in 72. It had some wonderful introductions for wannabe fans with tunes throughout the album from other artists. So as you hear this tune and kicking in, a bit shocking, sort of out of Stone's character. It's called Knee Trembler. Funky, grooving, jazzy. I can't hear any guitars. Driven by Bobby Keys here, who's back in the sessions, bass and drums and organ. Little improvisation going on. Who knows, maybe they were waiting for Mick and Keith and punched record. Maybe this might have been a tune for Ian McLagan's album. This now concluded the LA sessions. On September 9th, Mick attends Steve Martin's show at the Universal Amphitheater in Los Angeles. And who's opening up for him? The Blues Brothers. There, Mick gets to meet Belushi and Aykroyd. And by the way, Steve Jordan, the drummer for the Blues Brothers. Aykroyd and Belushi pushed Mick to persuade the Stones to appear on Saturday Night Live's season's premiere in 1 month. SNL was a hot show, and the Stones knew this. September 13th, Charlie and Bill attend the funeral of Keith Moon. The Who just released Who Are You a month earlier. Keith's overall health impacted everything he did, his performance, his appearance, and not being able to tour. He had been taking a powerful sedative to help his alcoholism, haminevrin. It did have some real heavy side effects. His alcohol, however, was getting cut back, and it was working. Now, Paul McCartney threw a party September 6th, Buddy Holly's 42nd birthday. He owned Buddy's Song Publishing. He bought the rights. And the movie, The Buddy Holly Story, was premiering that evening. Keith Moon did not want to go initially to the party, but his girlfriend eventually said she was going. And so he decided. And that's when he calls his dealer to get some cocaine. He didn't go crazy on the free champagne there, which was good. He was in good spirits. And he also mentioned to folks that he was planning to marry his girlfriend Annette. They did attend the movie later, and during the movie he started being agitated and he left about an hour into it, both he and Annette. He ate and he went to bed, and before bed he took his typical water and pills. He fell asleep by 4 a.m. So when Keith does something, it's usually excessive, and Annette didn't know how many he did take. Keith woke up at 7:30 a.m., hungry, in a bad mood. He ate, took some more pills, and he fell asleep. Due to his snoring, Annette leaves the room to sleep on the sofa, and she wound up waking up around 3:40 p.m. She went into the bedroom, and he was lying on his stomach, not breathing. She called all the protocols needed, but it was too late. Pronounced dead at 5:50, September 7th. Cause of death was overdose. Self-inflicted, but nothing showed suicide. Later, it was revealed that he had 26 undissolved tablets in his stomach. He lost control of his intake, died at 32 years old. September 15th. Respectable single is released. On the flip side, when the whip comes down. Now, during September through November, Ronnie worked on a solo album at Cherokee Studios. He was doing overdubs and editing and mixing his basic tracks from the earlier Paris sessions he did in March and April. Now, as Keith's trial is coming up, reports are still needed on his progress. Dr. Anita Stevens, on October 5th and 9th, reports remarkable progress and continuing absence of drug use. And Keith's lawyers, they choose trial by judge. The Stones met in New York City the first week of October. They stayed at the Essex House. Now, Keith and Ronnie, they would be buddying up with Aykroyd and Belushi preparing for their SNL appearance. It was a whirlwind partying. Belushi could actually keep up with Keith and more. The Stones set up some studio in Westchester also to hang out and prep for the SNL. Agreeing on Beast of Burden, Respectable, and Shattered to be performed. The new groupies would attend rehearsals, including Bill Murray, and there would be some jams. On September 6th, the Stones do a rehearsal, and here's some footage of the rehearsal. I played this on my Some Girls doc.
Isn't it great? We're going to do the whole thing again, though, so it gets less great as it goes on. Again, Loon. Tell us when you want to do it again.
Don't waste any more film.
I mean, don't waste any more. Oh, yeah. Oh, fuck. Thank God you're here.
Dead on me. Thank you.
the day of the show, the Stones arrived and they drank in the studio. They were gulping scotch and vodka, and there was open line of cocaine. Keith was so out of it, he was so not capable of delivering his lines and dialogue. He just had one line. And the network, they wanted Mick to wear underwear for the obvious reasons. There were some skits that were tried out still before the show that did not air, did not make it. Somewhere in the back studio, they were trying things, and several of them, they couldn't do. They couldn't pull it off. But here's some list of what they wore. Now, Mick, Ronnie, and Keith had vocal issues. Their throats were bad. They were hoarse and not in good shape for the performance. Mick's first skit that he did was with Aykroyd as Tom Snyder. And Charlie and Ronnie doing the classic, wonderful cheeseburger skit. Here with Aykroyd and also Bill Murray. And Ronnie did have some lines. And Charlie was asked if he was finished with the sandwich, and he just mumbled, yeah. Anyway, this was fantastic to see. This had to be chopped up because SNL will not allow any footage. As mentioned, Keith's skit was rejected, and it's a good thing. They were talking about his drug habits. They were going to say he needed to go to Switzerland. He was going to say that to get a blood transfusion before going to prison. Not a wise thing to do, and it was good that they dropped it again. He had one line and couldn't deliver. After the weekend update, the Stones played all three songs in a row. The introduction by Lorraine Newman. Very simple. Mick seemed to be obviously trying to push things a bit and show some edginess. There's the famous licking episode during Respectable. Here we could see it. This is Mick trying to be punk, different. As you could see, Ronnie taking it like a man. Doesn't seem to be enjoying it, but took it for the Stones. This seems to be the closure of the Some Girls period and the start of the new one. And as far as the performance goes, folks say it wasn't good. Some say it was good. It is what it is. It's the Stones giving us something. Three songs, Saturday Night Live for free. And I'm sure most of us enjoyed the hell out of it. October 9th, Dr. Stevens met Keith, and she reported he was responding well to his psychiatric treatment. He was dealing with the drug addiction and overcoming it. His lab test had no drugs in it. She recommended Keith to continue uninterrupted psychotherapy for 6 to 12 more months. Her report was forwarded onto Dr. Lewis Wahlberg, clinical professor of psychiatry at NYU Med School, New York University, and it was submitted to the court. So as we know, Keith got away with his relapse. Who knows what drugs they were testing for? Who knows who might have taken the test for Keith? October 22nd. Ronnie's girlfriend, Jo Howard, gives birth to a daughter, Leah.
I just thought what we'd do is get Keith's trial out of the way first, which is on Monday. Right, this is Monday, this will be shown after, so it'll be over by then. And then we'll put, then we thought we'd go to Australia, which we planned to do, and then we come back to England next year.
Mm. Well, if the worst should happen, does that mean that the Stones wouldn't be able to tour?
It's, as I said to you before, and it's going to sound ridiculous because it's going to be finished, it's, there's so many variables. I mean, what happens if Keith does this? What happens if they cut his head off? What happens if they, you know what I mean? So I just want to wait and to see what happens, and then, then we'll see what we do. Obviously, it's a bit difficult planning long, expensive tours while we don't know, which is why we don't know what we're doing.
But I mean, just, you wouldn't go on without him. I mean, you wouldn't go on stage without him.
I've been on stage with Adam. I went with Peter Tosh. Mm. On a stage with Peter Tosh. But the Stones, no, if, I mean, we wouldn't go on stage with if Keith was unavailable for a month. But, I mean, you know, I don't know, we just have to see.
Mm. How is he?
It's very well. He's in Los Angeles, sunning up.
Yeah, so he's in a reasonable state about
it. Oh, yeah, he's been very good spirits.
Because the last thing you did was the Saturday Night Live in
last
New
week.
York.
Yeah.
It must be the first live television show you've done for years and years.
Yeah, very little live television to do in America, apart from the sports. And there's very little live here now, really. Most of it's taped, isn't it?
Well, you'll have to come back and find out. But how did it go?
It was good fun. The sound was good. You know, we just did three numbers straight off.
How much did you have to rehearse it?
Oh, we did 4 days rehearsal.
4 days?
Dos.
Oh, that's with the comedy sketches as well?
Yeah, but for live television, that's it, because you've got no chance, you know, no chance at all.
Mm.
And a lot of people watched it, so they were very happy, though we didn't get paid, of course, like all television programmes. It's all charity.
No comment.
We did, we got $300. $300 for the band, right? And as I'm the leader, they put down, I got an extra bit.
Oh, how much did you get then? Go on.
$50 extra.
Oh, nice. Spend it carefully, Mick.
Oh, no.
You might need it.
We're moving on to the trial. October 21st, Keith flew up private jet with Austin Cooper, lawyer. They met at Four Seasons in Yorkville to prepare the plan for defense. Dr. Stevens' report was the primary asset. Cooper will firmly state the drugs found in Keith's room was for him, his own personal use. He has been conquering his addiction. One key factor was a star witness, the RCMP arresting officer, William Seward. He happened to be killed in a car accident on duty February 15, 1978. But Kennedy was still firm on arguing the heroin possession charge. His counter was that the others who got caught with less amount were thrown in jail. He also brought up Keith Cheyenne Walk raid June 26th and 73 in London. Kennedy wanted 6 to 12 months. October 23rd, Monday, 361 University Avenue Courthouse. Keith wearing a three-piece beige suit and brown shoes and a gold ring in his left ear. No Stones attended, but many fans waited on the courthouse steps lined up with Free Keith t-shirts. Approximately 75 people attended the courtroom for Judge Lloyd Grayburn, who was residing. But Cooper opened up saying his client would plead guilty to heroin possession charge on condition the other two were dropped. No need for a trial by jury. Kennedy had ultimately agreed to drop the trafficking charges and the cocaine charge. Cooper laid out Keith's heroin habits and mentioned that constant pressure of touring and recording took over his schedule and how he had a poor self-image and problems with others. He compared him to Van Gogh, Aldous Huxley, Billie Holiday, F. Scott Fitzgerald. Cooper reached out to Canadian Lorne Michaels to testify, basically to say how important Keith is to the band. Cooper also brought in a well-known Toronto music journalist since the 60s, Jack Batten. Jack was practicing law. Cooper thought his background would impress the judge, and Jack had initially felt this case didn't look good for Keith, but soon changed his mind as he saw the judge looking puzzled and bewildered. When Jack was cross-examined by Kennedy, he was asked, "Can you tell me, do any of their work discuss drugs or refer to drugs?" Now Jack would say, "Yeah, they do, but it's pretty common in all popular music." Well, how do they refer to drugs? Well, in some case, it is mocking. They convey what I presume to be the ecstasy that comes with taking the drugs. So what is being portrayed on this comet? They were not promoting heroin through his image and music. Cooper would continue his argument in reinforcing Dr. Stevens' reports, saying Keith kicked his habit and the only reason to jail him would be that he will commit further crimes to get heroin. He then stated that Keith was willing to raise $1 million for some drug rehab program. It would benefit the public to allow Keith to continue his music and to continue his treatment. Now, Judge Grayburn's colleague, Judge Ray Stortini, he had a project he was working on that sentenced nonviolent offenders to work in need of volunteers instead of jail time and waste taxpayers' money. Judge Grayburn's assistant was from Dartford, England. After October 23rd, the session adjourned, Grayburn had called his colleague to see if this case would be a likely candidate for this volunteering. The next day, October 24th, Judge Grayburn would give a one-hour explanation of his sentencing. Keith got a one-year suspended sentence with probation for another year. Keith would have to keep a clean criminal record and continue therapy with Dr. Stevens and meet with a Toronto probation officer in the spring and fall of 79. Also, Keith would have to perform a concert within 6 months in Toronto, with all proceeds going to the Canadian National Institute for the Blind, the CNIB. No jail, no fine. Keith had noticed his blind angel, Rita Bedard, in the courtroom on the first day. If you have no clue who Rita is, then please go watch my prior video documentaries, see what she's about. Keith did speak with Rita. Now, Rita was partially blind, not fully blind. How the concert for the blind was decided is still not known for sure. Couple things. Keith's version was that Rita had gone to the judge's home that first night and convinced him. Others say Cooper saw Keith and Rita talking, came up with the idea of the CNIB show, and offered it to the judge. The last version is the judge had noticed Rita in the courtroom and had read in a newspaper article about the CNIB and the state of their finances. It was in a gloomy state. He decided on his own to reach out to the CNIB for permission for a benefit concert. The CNIB spokesperson had said Keith's name was not mentioned. So as the sentencing was read, the courtroom filled the room with cheers when the verdict was ended and Keith gave a fist pump. Keith would thank Jack Batten with a handshake. Keith would be hurried back in a brown station wagon to the Four Seasons. He would call Anita in the Frog Hollow Westchester home. He would also call his mom and then Mick and let them know the news. He would then show up for a press conference downstairs and wear his jeans and t-shirt and a leather jacket, a little more relaxed. Keith would be able to use his return bail money to convince the Stones to do a benefit.
Rolling Stones fans were absolutely delighted with the judge's decision not to send their hero to jail.
It's like, it's going to help him, he's going to kick his habit, and it's going to help us. He's still going to be out there putting out records.
He's not like every one of us. He's different. He's Keith.
Here at the courthouse, the judge took 40 minutes to say essentially the same thing. Noting that Keith Richards isn't your usual drug addict, the judge imposed an extraordinary sentence, including the obligation to give a special benefit concert for young people here in Toronto at the Canadian National Institute for the Blind. Judge Lloyd Grayburn of County Cork said drug addicts are normally jailed either because they turn to crime to buy drugs or because they refuse to try to kick the habit. But this wasn't the case. The judge portrayed Richards as a hard-working, creative artist whose effort to get off drugs was an example for others. So Richards got off with the provision that he perform for the blind, a performance he says the Rolling Stones will organize within 6 months.
I feel very good about it, obviously, yeah. I think it's fair, slightly strange.
Richards told the news conference that he wouldn't recommend the use of drugs, but he wasn't about to become a preacher.
I guess our music will reflect the any changes in attitude that are prevalent amongst society and amongst people. We can't do any more than that, you know. We don't preach nothing.
As the rock star prepared to leave town, the Canadian National Institute for the Blind expressed pleasure with the idea of a benefit concert. A spokesman said they were consulted, but it still came as a big surprise. David Bazet, CBC News, Toronto.
October 25th, the day after. Keith is back in New York City and celebrating his freedom. How and why Keith ended up on stage with Rockpile, not sure. And hopefully you know who Rockpile is. If not, I gotta say Dave Edmunds, Nick Lowe, Billy Bremer, all-star band, fabulous music. Rockpile was ending a five-night stint at the famous Bottom Line. And rumor had it that Keith was showing up. He went backstage and Nick Lowe had asked Keith if he wanted to sit in on a few tunes. Rockpile agreed to have Keith come in halfway through the act to play Let It Rock. Simple enough. You'll see where it goes from there. Keith was in a haze, which Nick and Dave did notice. They decided to have Keith come on stage at the start. Keith seemed somewhat disarrayed and not sure which amp was his when he got on stage. He played a Gibson ES-335 and a Music Man amp right behind him.
I'm going to start playing and we got a surprise for you, okay? Keith Richards!
They got through Chuck's song and they went into Rockpile music, which he was getting through. Nick was pleased. Keith started feeling it and then he lost his balance and he went backwards into the amp right behind him. High and embarrassed, who knows, but a roadie came by and took him off, quietly off. Keith did look a bit perplexed and seemed a bit slighted trying to understand what was done wrong. There are bootlegs of this show, as you can hear.
Less than ounces. In the years when you were a junkie, you were presumably in danger sometimes as much from the people you had to deal with as from the drugs themselves.
In the States and a few other hot spots in the world, mostly at that time, I don't think so much now, but there were a couple of times in New York these people had incredible setups, works out, you know, look out for the cops and go around, and suddenly some paranoid junkie would scream at their coming, and a couple of times bullets would thud into the wall, and just, forget it, I'll cold turkey. But, New York can be real rough on that.
So you'd have to wander out among these guys after a concert or whatever.
The next time you take a gun with you, that was it. You know, I carried a piece in those days.
How long do you carry a gun for?
Until I stopped being a junkie, you know, until I didn't have to deal with that anymore, you know.
That's just a vital part of self-preservation, was it?
Yeah, because you'd buy the stuff, walk down the stairs, and they'd have their mate waiting downstairs, stick you up and take it back again. You know? So, can't have that.
Now, also, the CNIB, meanwhile, had some hesitation of a drug user being affiliated with them. But they did have a legal advice team and approached the event with caution. And of course, the Canadian government, there were still rumblings of disappointment of the case by the top conservative Canadian officials for Keith's lenient sentence that they felt they want an appeal. In October, or might have been November, not sure, but New York City radio station WNEW-FM, huge station, a DJ was working on an Atlantic Peter Tosh Bush Doctor radio commercial. Mick agreed to come in and work with Dennis Elsis, DJ, in Manhattan to create a promotional jingles for Bush Doctor. Bush Doctor was released November 3rd. Not sure why, probably legal issues, that it was not released sooner with the tour with the Stones. Mick saw Peter play in New York City's Bottom Line, and Peter did ask Mick to join in. Mick also films a video clip with Peter for Don't Look Back. Now at the Bottom Line, when Mick was there, when he was asked to join, he was actually in the back, and they lifted him up and passed him over the audience's head from the back to the stage. That must have been hilarious.
What have you been doing since the tour finished? Have you been doing any more writing?
I've been writing. I've done a bit of rehearsing. And
what do you mean?
Well, yeah, we rehearsed and we've played a lot since, you know, and we've written a lot of songs. The new album.
When do you think that might happen then?
I don't know. Well, I suppose it happens to Keith. I have to go and finish it off on myself. But no, Keith will get out on appeal. I mean, there's no problem. And we'll go straight into the studio, and it'll be out probably early spring.
Well, the Canadian Federal Justice Minister, Otto Lane, ordered an appeal. He would receive hundreds of outraged letters of leniency that was given towards Keith. Prosecutor John Scolin was granted to file an appeal by May 31st, 1979. Scolin was really annoyed with the verdict, and he felt Canada appeared spineless on drug enforcement, and he wanted a 2-year sentence. For the holidays, December 12th, the release of Run Rudolph Run, Keith on guitar, vocals, and bass, Stu on piano, Mike Driscoll on drums. This was recorded 2 years earlier with the John Phillips sessions. And the flip side, The Harder They Come from the August LA sessions on the B-side.
Run away when Rudolph had a
fantastic. Remember that. And vinyl, red vinyl. You see, it doesn't count any better than that. It's the way it is. Beautiful. Also, apparently, you get a Christmas card. This is really, I mean, what more can I say? You know, this is the stuff, man.
December 16th, Peter Tosh on Saturday Night Live with Mick backing up. Don't Look Back. Keith was there hanging out. So it's Christmas time, December 78. Keith is with Anita, taking her with Marlon to see his mom in London. And he stays there for several weeks. He's actually there mid-January, where he's interviewed by Melody Maker, by Chris Welsh. They're at the Ritz Hotel in Piccadilly. And the article actually opens up with Anita, with a constant barrage of interruptions. She would answer questions for Keith and try to control the conversation. Keith would counter, saying, "Look, darling, will you please shut up?" As Chris would ask about the Some Girls tour, Anita would respond again, saying, "He's got future plans, I tell you." Very obnoxious, and Keith would still lay into her, but she was just persistent with his comments. Keith would talk about his current view on England. He would say he liked Ian Dury. The punks went wrong by trying to make four-track records on 32-track machines. Great theater, and was it all crap? Anita would respond, mumble, mumble. "Keith, look, darling, who's doing the interview?" And Keith was asked about reggae and talking about living in Jamaica and how reggae was not as popular 5 years ago. Anita would continue with delivering more bullshit. And now you're thinking, why is Keith just with her and hanging out? And why is she still in the same room? Keith would talk about his trial, having to stand in the courtroom and be bored and had to listen to it all. And he would say, now they want an appeal and make it a Canada versus the Stones. He thought the trial judge did his best to please everybody. And Keith would also mention how not one of his Mounties that busted him wore a uniform when they came into his hotel room. Well, January 79, after the London visit, Keith flies to Jamaica. He loved the reggae, as we know, and he even considered doing a reggae album himself. But down there, he worked with Sly and Robbie in recording with Black Uhuru. This was at the Channel One Studios in Kingston, and Robbie had formed the band. Now, Keith would play on a few cuts and few tracks, but there's one song that's stuck on the album that has him, Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, on Shine Eye Gal. The album was released March 1980. What he does on this track is more of a guitar chunking reggae riff, no leads. But if you want more, you can listen to the 2009 extended mix from Taxi Records. With Keith at a new peak of his life, his direction for control was growing and growing each day, and his clashes with Mick will become evident. As mentioned, Keith really wanted a tour. He wanted to go through Europe, Australia, for the Some Girls, and was open for the taking. But Mick's refusal infuriated him. The crew and some special guests start their official Emotional Rescue Sessions, located down at Compass Point Studios, Nassau, Bahamas. They would record approximately 40 songs in these 79 sessions for Emotional Rescue. 25 were about acceptable. They were there from about January 18th to February 12th, 1979. The Stones would choose Bahamas because it did not have the same tax restraints as the U.S. did. Plus, Keith just loved the Caribbean and the sun. Now, Compass Point Studio was home of great music. As you could see this list, it is just so mind-blowing how powerful it was. As Chris Blackwell founded the studio in 1977, he's the owner of Island Records. But to talk about some of the history, in short, the studio started to get neglected as Chris was expanding into other interests, and a key manager producer died in a car crash. And in the late 80s, that is when the studio sort of went on a bad slide. The equipment was just outdated and suffered lack of maintenance. In the early 90s, Chris brought in a new manager who had success in the U.S., Terry Manning. Terry did a massive overhaul and reopened in 92. The producer-engineer brag list is a who's who. Sadly to say, by 2010, due to local incidents, I have no idea what it was, but these occurred at or near their studio and was decided to close. So Chris Kimsey is back in action as the assistant producer and engineer, is back to business in such a beautiful location. He even brought his wife. You can understand why they opened with this tune in the session. It's Cold Down There is the title of this one. Not a real standout, but it's just a fun calypso reggae beat. Halfway in, we hear Mick ad-libbing some nonsensical words. Okay, we know this one. I think I'm going mad. It originated here in Nassau, but would not rear up until more work was done on it in 82 and 83 at Pathe Marconi and a Hit Factory, and it came out in 84. The flip side to She Was Hot. I remember getting that single and being proud of it. This version I'm playing is not great quality, but it has Keith singing the vocals. It's approximately 15 minutes long. We get to hear Ronnie on the early version playing the sax here. This song was most likely written by Mick. We hear probably Stu on piano, or maybe Mick. This one wanted to be a ballad, but was considered too weak at this time to push it. Plus, there were other ballads already for Emotional Rescue. Ronnie would play pedal steel on this, and Mel Collins would later come in with sax on the B-side version. Robert Johnson's Sweet Home Chicago, but with a face. Another cover, worth the listen, and with singing blues, isn't it always? Pretty straight up as expected, and you wonder why they jammed this one. Was it to get sound, loosen up, or was this one going to be worked on? Still in Love. This one was addressed in both the Bahamas and Pathe Marconi. But in 82, during Undercover, it was an instrumental. Here's the Pathe version, and you could hear a real pretty song developing. Chris would call it a beautiful melody. A bit hazy and fuzzy sound, I would have to think Mick on the piano, Ronnie joining in with a country twang. And this is also an undercover outtake. At the top. This one has a bit of Some Girls in it. Straight ahead mid-rocker with plenty of Keith licks being displayed. This one was talked about prior in Some Girls and known as Mick would carry it over to his solo album in 85, She's the Boss album. Totally different arrangement. Especially that 80s drum sound. Not a fan of that album for sure, but the videos, I gotta say, are even worse. All right, let's move on.
What do you think has carried you through all that?
It wasn't difficult. I have a great life, man. I found what it is I wanted to do very early, and I got very successful at it very early, and the people all around the world like what I do. What's so hard? What's so difficult? You know, that can, everybody has struggles in their life. You know, I've had baby die, and been busted, I've been threatened with jail and death and all kinds of other things, but who hasn't? In one form or another, not necessarily those same charges, but everybody knows what I mean. It's life, Good things.
This song is a bit interesting and a bit out of the Stones character. This one is called Guitar Lesson, also known as Again and Again and Again. Groove that seems to have Ronnie on guitar playing his California beach party sound. And he's utilizing that MXR. Charlie and Bill shuffling along and Keith working it, getting his chuck licks in. The rock and roll guitar sound is interesting. Seemed to not be pouring out the way it has prior, especially with the last Some Girls sessions. The creativity was a challenge with Mick and Keith. Chris, he was also challenged with these dynamics that he was facing now. He noticed it. The band, they did enjoy the weather and beauty outside the studio. Keith was a sun worshipper, and Chris, he would go snorkeling with Stu and go out driving. With folks enjoying the atmosphere around the island, Alan Dunn, Stone's assistant, and his girlfriend Ramona Herman went missing while they were in an 8-foot dinghy. They were diving about 400 feet off a reef. Stu, Mick, Bill, and Astrid and security spent about 2.5 days going out in a rescue aircraft, looking and looking. They were eventually picked up safe, but suffered exposure and definitely had dehydration. Bill would mention that during the sessions, Keith did not sleep for 4 days at one time, and it annoyed Mick so much that he refused to come to the studio. And he was commenting how out of it Keith was, and he was not getting anything done. Song Never Too Into. Keith is relentless with him looking for riffs. This one has three guitars using the MXR. To me, it sounds a bit post-punk. The Stones purist, I'm not sure if they're gonna dig this one, but you gotta give it a full listen if you're gonna wanna judge it. Mick throwing some random words in. Some ooze. Totally a work in progress, and Keith definitely doing some different sound soloing over that again and again. Bill and Charlie grooving rhythms. Another one that's interesting and different. This next song, Let's Go Steady Again, also known as She Left Me and Let's Go Steady, a Sam Cooke tune, covered by several folks, and should have heard this one before. As I mentioned earlier, Chris's wife was there, Christy Kimsey. She was hanging out at Compass Point. She's a singer-songwriter. She had recorded an album at Longview Farm Studio in Massachusetts. It's called As I Look Back. Now this tune included Let's Go Steady Again, which she had the idea. There was also a tune she did and covered with Alvin Lee and also Mick Ralphs, a song called Trying to Get Back to You. So this album that she had done was produced, engineered by Chris. Now back to the tune. When Keith was working on this tune one night, he called Christy to come down. She agreed she would, but not at the time of the night that Keith called. She came later that morning, as you can imagine. She heard the tune. It had Ronnie on sax. So there was no rehearsals. No deciding who would sing what line. They just did it in one take. They both sang together. And this is a beautiful tune all around. Love the guitars. The New Barbarians, when they toured, they played and covered this tune. Taking your love from me. Thank you.
trouble with Christianity. Is that Christian?
A Jagger Richard tune, but Ja Is Not Dead is definitely a Keith influence. Who else? When you first hear the guitar, it does not have that crisp chunka-chunka rhythm, that reggae riff. This is out-of-the-box guitars. Mick comes right in. He's taught well by Peter Tosh on the delivery. Now the lyrics, not religious, but the hilarious part of this song, after Mick goes on with Ja Is Not Dead, he blurts out, if you want to do coke, do it in the other room.
Ja Is Not Dead. If you want to do a coke, do it out in the other room.
Directing it to somebody as he probably picked his head up and saw something going on that he didn't like. Again, the crunchy and lead guitars and bass pounding in an unusual way and sound. Okay, facts about who's singing on this song, backup. Is it Max Romeo? Is it Boss Gags? Is Boss Gags also playing guitar? I'm not sure, so I'm going to put that out there. Also, did Jagger and Richards, write this song, or Mick, or whomever? But on itsonlyrockandroll.org, Felix Apelli, he said that Hamilton Castell or Rodney Winston Godfrey wrote that song sometime maybe in the 70s, but I'm just going to go and say I'm not sure. So you decide, you listen, and take it from there.
He got the big ticket, baby. He bought the big one.
Here are two blues jams recorded. Straightforward jamming, trying things out. Also a tune, Guess I Should Know. Nothing earth-shattering. A slow-paced tune with a lot of Keith on guitar and the MXR. Ronnie's guitar is heard. It's up front. And I like Bill's bass playing on this tune. Breakaway. This one has an older 70s feel, somewhat. A bit of a mishmash sound, kind of muddy. Mick singing whatever he wants, can't make it out. I think this had something still too early to tell, but the structure and idea makes you wonder. This one you've seen a lot on the bootlegs, Linda Lou. Not a Stone song. It's from Texas, a cover tune written by Ray Sharp, a bouncy teen rocker from 1959, rockabilly tune. A friend of Ray's asked him to write about his girlfriend who just loved to dance, but wanted to sort of rib her some in this lyrics. See, she had a nice backside that folks loved to watch. Lee Hazelwood was his producer. If you remember, Bobby Keys played with Bobby V in 63. He covered the tune also. So would it be Johnny Kidd and the Pirates who covered it in the UK in 61? Not sure why this or how this song came about. Rockabilly so put in some nice MXR slap, a fun one. I really like how different that money solo is at 2 minute mark. And Ronnie has some nice leads later on. Mick changes the lyrics around it. The song at 2:32, he sings, "Had a real bad dream last night. She went and fucked Ronnie." What's the Matter? Slow blues boogie with Mick throwing out the lyrics in a softer tone. He must be playing something as he's calling out the chords. At one point he says, "Go ahead, Woody, to play a little lick." There's some harp, which was overdubbed, and there's some piano by Stu. Totally different vibe than Some Girls. Favorite to many, Bulldog. Well, you can hear where they went with this one. Also known as Little TNA. Has a sound in the beginning here as She's So Cold, that intro on this take. Using the MXR analog delay with a pedal steel. The tune was intended for Emotional Rescue, but for whatever reason, was put aside until 81. They wanted to get the songs out for Tattoo You and brought this one in. Why not? Love this version in its raw and different state. Now, Martin Elliott, author, would mention in his book on this tune, the line, "The pool's in, but the patio ain't dry." We know it. The line is from actually Lenny Bruce, the comedian from the 60s. He had a book, and there was a skit he was talking about, and that was in the skit. And Keith read this book and brought it to life another way. So February 12th, Mick, Charlie, and Ronnie flew home. Keith would say it was crazy that everyone had left when it was all going so well. And in Bill's book, he would say this and then continue saying that Keith had to have been joking. The next day, Keith and Lil wanted to have dinner with Bill and Astrid, who was still there. Bill and Astrid tried to avoid them. In March, Dr. Stevens had her medical license revoked. She had this after pleading guilty to overbilling New York State, the Medicaid program. She had to pay $50,000 in fines. Now, later in February, Keith started hanging out with Belushi in New York City. And then in March, Belushi started hanging out with Ronnie in L.A. Patty Hansen was discovered selling hot dogs at her father's concession stand on the beach in Staten Island when she was 16 years old. Six siblings and being the youngest. One had passed before she was born. A Norwegian with a real tight working class family. In 1973, it was Wilhelmina Modeling Agency that told her parents she could make $100,000 a year. Her father gave the blessing and she traveled around the world for 2 years. Graduating to Vogue, she became to be known for her freckles. 5'9", 130 pounds. Patty was 18, living on her own in New York City, partying and dancing and working, living it up. On March 17th in 79, she was 23 and partying at Studio 54. Patty was introduced to Keith after being pulled from dancing wildly on the dance floor. She said hi and she went back to dancing. Jane Rose was there. She knew Keith. She saw his expression on his face. She said it was a glimmer in his eye as he watched her dance. She felt and knew she was the one. At this time, this concludes part one of the making of Emotional Rescue in the time period. Got a lot out of it myself, and I am sure you did too. A lot here, a lot more to do, and I hope you pass this on to friends and let them know about it. Anybody that's into rock and roll, and of course, the greatest rock and roll band, the Rolling Stones.
Obviously a lot of struggles, you know, been near death's door a couple of times.
Oh, so they say. I was never aware. I never even saw the front door of it, let alone the entrance, you know. I mean, as far as I was concerned, I mean, other people projected that I was at death's door. As far as I make sure, man, that's why I'm still here. I make sure that I'm very, very fair distance from death's door, you know, and but other people, they kind of want to wish it on you. They want, you know what I mean?
In a way, why?
Well, I don't know. That's human condition. You know, I don't know. But I mean, as far as I know, you really number one on the list. Look out, Cook, I'll be around. You know? And to prove it, I'm here.